My opinion, though, for me personally, I think the best investment I can personally make is in...
How's it going, everyone? It's Sam. Today, we're going to be listening to Whitney Webb. Actually, a couple different podcasts that she's gone on describing issues of today and where power lies, what people don't understand. Actually, before posting these videos, I always think about titles. And there are a lot of interesting ones that we could use because she has some pretty insane things to talk about. They want to give unprecedented control to the government. The government is legalized crime. You need to know what BlackRock is truly doing. The best investment you can make. And the government wants your Bitcoin. They actually want to seize your Bitcoin. There's a lot to cover in today's video. If you guys like this kind of stuff, hit subscribe. Turn on the bell notification underneath the video so you can see future videos just like this. I made a Whitney Webb video just a day or two ago. And a lot of people liked it, so we're making another one here. She is an investigative journalist who really tries to dig into what's truly happening behind the scenes, what people don't know and what people don't really want to look too closely at because it gets a little bit scary. If you want to trade crypto, there is a link to Margex and to CoinW underneath the video where you can start trading today. They also have an airdrop going on just a little bit longer. So definitely check out those links, but let's get into the video.
But it was kind of this weird thing because, you know, this is Elizabeth Warren, and even as a politician, you can't trust her. But historically, she has stood up against Wall Street banks, and now she seems to be arm in arm with them.
Yeah, well, that, I don't know. I think there's a lot of people in Congress that get into Congress campaigning on certain issues, and then once they're there long enough, they backtrack completely. There's a lot of examples of that historically and currently in the U.S., for sure. So, I mean, Elizabeth Warren is garbage. The DNC got all this money, what, from Sam Bankman-Fried? You know, how anti-crypto are they really? I think it's they're willing to play ball, and set up regulations and be the kingmakers in the crypto industry. I think there's a lot of, I think that's going to happen. And then they're going to try and nix everything that doesn't serve them. And again, financial privacy being the main thing that doesn't serve them. But they also want to give unprecedented control to the DOJ to go and contact any crypto exchange or even Tether, right? And be like, freeze these wallets. We've decided those wallets need to be frozen, you know? So that's escalating, obviously. And, you know, the whole thing that happened with Binance is like a big push towards that as well, because now Binance is basically going to have a chaperone appointed by the U.S. government, basically in charge of everything. Their chief compliance officer is a guy that used to work for, you know, the Department of Justice. Yeah, come on.
Is that because Binance is it because they recognize where the world is going with regards to crypto and Bitcoin, and Binance actually has its tentacles stretched to nearly every country in the world? You know, when I've traveled with my podcast or filmmaking, all the locals are using Binance. Is that just to get control of the biggest crypto financial infrastructure?
I'm sure that's a big part of it, because, you know, so a big complaint about Binance from the DOJ is that they were allowing people that were subjected to U.S. sanctions to use their service, but they're not really like a U.S. company, are they? But the U.S. government, I mean, U.S. is an empire. They want to be able to go to any country and say, you can't do that. We're actually in charge. You know what I mean? So Binance not being under their thumb and being active in all these other countries, allowing people in Iran to use their services, for example. I mean, that was a big sticking point for them. It wasn't like criminals, terrorists in Iran. It was just like people in Iran. They're subject to U.S. sanctions. You're not complying with U.S. sanctions. And so we're going to charge you $1 billion and take out your chief executive and put our people in charge, you know? This is the mafia, guys. I wrote a 1,000-page book about how the government is in the U.S. is organized crime, specifically the Department of Justice, and that's what they're doing. And keep in mind too, the DOJ has an insane amount of Bitcoin it holds, and they want more.
Yeah,
you know, and they want to seize Bitcoin from what?
Your book? What the 1,000?
One Nation Under Blackmail. It's the second volume is about Epstein, and the first volume is about how the conditions for Epstein being who he was came into existence. It starts, I guess, in the 30s.
And so it's on Audible. Is it you reading it?
No, it's someone else.
I bought it.
Well, you know, it's...
Am I giving money to the evil Amazon, though?
That's what, I mean, a lot of people do. Well, I mean, they're a monopoly, so it's kind of hard to, like, sell books without it. You know what I mean?
So where is the resistance, Whitney? Like, you know, I fear all this, and I found myself, I don't know, both of us have been kind of like laughing through this because everything is so ridiculous.
Insane.
But
yeah.
it's also terrifying. Yeah, in my world, a lot of people think that Bitcoin is the resistance. You take control of the money, you take the power away from them. Do you give any credence to that? I mean, how down the Bitcoin rabbit hole are you?
Well, you know, I definitely think Bitcoin has the potential to be a tool for financial freedom, but I think it's definitely, there's major efforts well underway to co-opt that to serve the same agenda, right? And so I think people in the Bitcoin space that want it to be a tool for financial freedom need to get wise to those efforts to co-opt and resist, because it's either a tool of financial freedom or it's not. You know what I mean? And so...
yeah.
If you seed enough territory and let them like completely dollarize Bitcoin and turn it into like a tool of U.S. empire to keep the dollar afloat and like, you know, keep dollar hegemony going forever and ever and ever. And, you know, are saying it's a flaw in Bitcoin that you like can't put dollars easily on Bitcoin and all of this. I mean, no, I mean, the whole point supposedly, right, of creating Bitcoin was to give Wall Street banks the middle finger and create something that had immutable sound monetary policy, correct? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if you allow them to co-opt it so it's not those things anymore, what are you left with?
The same old world.
Is it a tool of financial freedom, or is it just, has it, the promise of Bitcoin been hollowed out and replaced with Wall Street garbage?
Is that what you think the issue there, like ETFs, are you alluding to the ETFs?
There's all sorts of things that are happening in Bitcoin right now that could be under that umbrella. But when you start to have people like BlackRock being like, you know what, we actually like Bitcoin now, that's a sign to pay attention. You know what I mean?
Bitcoin is hope.
So I think people need to, in the Bitcoin space, need to be very aware that there is a fight being had right now about the future of Bitcoin. And you have to decide which side you're on. Are you going to fight for Bitcoin to be a tool of financial freedom, or are you going to allow it to be co-opted by the powers that be that it was supposedly designed to resist them and, you know, be something they can't control? Are you going to give them control of it? I mean, the answer should be no to any Bitcoiner worth respecting.
Well, this is a good place to ask you. You're obviously into Bitcoin. When did you first hear about it? How long have you been in it? And do you think that Bitcoin can stand up to the corruption that exists in this system?
Okay, so I'm like, I like have crypto mainly because, you know, financial censorship has been a big problem for independent media, especially in the past couple of years. So I like to have, you know, diversity of assets, I guess you could say. Like, I don't want to have all my money in cash in the bank or something like that, depending on what could happen, because there's a lot of different risks and a lot of different ways things could play out. So I do have crypto, but I also, like, I don't promote it because I don't feel like it's my place to tell people how to spend their money and what to do. In my opinion, though, for me personally, I think the best investment I can personally make is in land right now, you know, because I can have my own house. I can, at least in Chile, have like off-grid energy pretty easily and cheaply, you know, water, grow my own food. I can take care of my family myself and be like self-sufficient for me personally. Like, that's the best investment for me to make right now. So, you know, I've listened to a lot of arguments about Bitcoin and stuff. And I mean, if you're all in for it, that's cool. If you're not, that's cool. I'm not going to try and like convince people one way or the other, because I feel like, again, it's not my place, because a lot of the work I do is aimed at showing, you know, where the power really lies and identifying the problem so that, you know, other people can talk about how to solve it. You know, I have some ideas about like solutions that I think could work, but, you know, I'm the bulk of my work is about trying to identify, you know, the state of affairs, where the roots of the problems lie. So, you know, because we can't solve any problems unless we know what the problem is.
What do you think about what Whitney Webb said? Do you think financial firms have more control than most people think? Let me know down below in the comments. Let me know if you want me to make more videos like this too. One way that you can do that is by hitting subscribe. If you want to trade crypto, there is a link underneath the video to Margex and to CoinW. Thanks so much. I'll see you in the next video. Bye.